She's an architect by training, but a social entrepreneur at heart. Her entrepreneurship lens is colored by her own personal experiences as a daughter, sister, and women's advocate in her home country, Bangladesh. Welcome back to Season 8 of Womenpreneur Asia. I'm your host, Krista Good, and my mission is to uncover the stories and strategies of Asian women entrepreneurs in Asia to inspire you as you navigate your own business journey. This episode is sponsored by Redbox Studio. Today, I'm speaking to Tareem Shah of Bangladesh. She is the co-founder of not one, but two startups. Tareem is the co-founder and head of growth at Amar Lab, based in Singapore. She describes it as the Uber for medical diagnostics. Second, she is the co-founder of Borosha, an alternative job sourcing platform in Bangladesh that connects informal sector women with skills training and matches them to better paying jobs. I was connected to Tareem through Risa Kazui, another remarkable woman. So thank you, Risa, for this connection. In this episode, Tareem openly shares her personal struggles, such as her father's health, life decisions, and being divorced, and how this intersect with her passion for design, business, and technology in her startups. Enjoy this episode. Hello, Tareem. Welcome to Womenpreneur Asia.
Hi, thanks, Krista. It's an honor to be here.
So, Tareem, you have had such a busy schedule. It was quite hard to pin you down, and you've been traveling.
Yeah. Quite the busy beginning of a year or first quarter, I must say. But I think that's how it is when you have your business headquartered in Singapore and then you have it operational in Dhaka, Bangladesh, which is the capital city.
So today you are in Bangladesh, right?
Right. I just came back from more than a month of a stay in Singapore where there was a lot of commitment in business expansion, investment and other responsibilities.
Tareem, before we get into all the good stuff about what you're doing today in the tech space, I'd like to know, who is Tareem?
Great. That's a good question, Krista. And I think that's when everyone feels a bit like, okay, who am I? And this kind of reminds me of that I Am Remarkable workshop that I was blessed to do this time when I was in Singapore, and some of us female founders were invited by the head of APEC in Google. And the entire workshop was about how females don't know how to say what exactly they do and shy away, or they want to be very humble and not talk about whatever they have
done. Profile,
but
right?
Of course, after that workshop, I think I can speak much more better about my achievements, my milestone, my dreams and my goals, and how far I have come together with the support as an individual. I am a daughter. I'm an elder daughter. I am a caring, loving sister. And I am a girl who moved away from home 10 years ago. I basically was raised in the most southern part of Bangladesh. And a lot of you who wouldn't know where Bangladesh is, it is not part of India. It's a country which has more than 125 million population, a small country, but very powerful, dynamic economy. And currently I'm residing in the capital city, Dhaka, which has more than 25 million people. And we are going to become one of the top 10 economies in the next 10 years. So yes, that is, I'm proud to be a Bangladeshi. And once I moved away from my home, I became an architecture student, pursuing my passion, and discovered that in my studies, it is actually beyond building boundaries or interior design or the aesthetics of it or the functional aspects of buildings. But eventually my interest, after my third year when I did my internship in Norway, I became more of a sensitized enthusiast, trying to understand how design could impact lives, or as a young female student back then and a young female professional now, how I could probably be there for the community and work together and build something. I would also like to say that I am actually a divorcee as well, someone who was married quite young when she was just 21, probably didn't even know what it meant. But I think that also shaped up for me to just be there for instances or situations where probably I couldn't find someone and be much more empathetic and kinder as a human being as I'm growing older. And understanding how, as an individual, I can have a proper balance between my profession as well as me as a person and like the personal aspect of it, which did eventually shape me or led me to become a female founder, where I did start my own social business back in 2019 when COVID hit. It's called Porosha, and I built it with some amazing female co-founders initially, and now my co-founder is Tahana. She is in a break now, and we have kept Porosha at a break, but working with female leaders and working with the female friends who inspire you as well eventually has led me to even build my next venture, which is actually a health tech business. And I am also a co-founder and leading the digital transformation of that company, which is called Amar Lab. And we will obviously go deeper into it, but just a person who's a female founder at this point. It's still quite hard actually to say what I'm doing or not. So yeah, quite in the middle of you know, being humble and actually saying your achievements. I am an architect by trade and a social entrepreneur by passion.
That is a really great introduction to who Tareem is. But I really would like to get into the part where you said that in Norway, right? Where you were studying architecture and then you realized that it was more than just architecture.
Right.
In like buildings, right?
Buildings, right.
And aesthetics.
Right.
Was there
right.
any pivotal moment when you were that aha moment or brought the aha moment to life?
It's actually more than an aha moment. It was like, let me sit down, take a few steps back and think how things have been different. It was a very difficult time after graduating my school that I felt like all of my friends were leaving for their university. They were in different global parts of the world pursuing the undergrad they were excited about. And I was like thinking whether I would get scholarship with my dad's health condition. And even though I have like the best grades, you know, it might get quite expensive. I don't know. Things were a bit difficult, but still I started studying architecture in Brac, which is one of the top universities and is led by the largest NGO in the world. And I am quite blessed to actually have been introduced to the faculty or the education system over there, because that eventually led me to do my internship in Norway, right? Even though I was studying in my home country, I did have a global exposure. I realized it doesn't matter in which part of the world you are, be it the most like, you know, cleanest country or the best country having the like happiest people or whatsoever, or the best economy, you would eventually be years behind because of your gender. And the struggle of a female architecture student or a female architect in Norway itself has been quite challenging when I was working hands-on with the firms over there and the people over there, be it male or female, understanding that some challenges does not change. And that's when I realized that since I'm privileged to know this, feel this, understand this, and I can obviously have an upper hand to contribute, even if it's like just pushing a small needle of change, right, through spreading awareness or having an important conversation once I come back to my country and finish my thesis, because it was in the middle of my undergrad education, right? I was like, I have to work on something where it's not gonna be the same as what I'm seeing. Even if it means that it's on a micro community scale or on a very small scale. So that is the realization I had when I was working in Oslo in my office and with Niels, my then boss and my first boss ever, or my first line manager, right? They hate being called boss, but boss is something they're very used to calling in Bangladesh. But yeah, so even Niels himself, you know, being based in the Norway, was not getting the right payment by the client, and the client was not appreciating his work, his creativity, and he was struggling as well. Even though he's like super senior, worked with some of the top and like the Oscar winning in architecture is called Pritzker. So he also worked under the Pritzker winning architect. architects, but still struggling. And then imagine how difficult it has been for female architects. So that is a realization I had and I brought back with me. And it was the very fact that a lot of us young people in my country think that things are so much shinier out there, but actually not, and so much tougher for females. So yeah.
So that's how you came to the realization. Was that also how it spurred you to do something when you came back to Bangladesh?
Right. So the next phase, what happened was when I had that exposure, I realized that, okay, in architecture, in design, these are the things that you face challenges with. So with your academia, you can cover some of the challenges. That is to know how to do your job better. But probably to do your job better are like the hard skills. But what about the soft skills as a female? In my class, there was a lot of female students, but eventually when we transitioned to the job sector, it's more of the maid in the field, you know, be it construction or even within the office, like construction site or even within the office. So what actually happens, or what is that pain point faced by the female students or female young professionals? So I realized for me to understand that I would probably need to work in more, I wouldn't say more organizations, but rather at different capacity or understanding the pain point a bit better. So that's when I was like, okay, these are the things I can learn from my field, my group of people, my circle of people, or my education. But what about these other things that I can't? How do I understand how to negotiate better? How to work with others? How to work with cross-discipline? Or as a female student, what are the challenges that I might face in the real world, and how can I prep myself better? And that's when I actually started doing some part-time jobs other than my studies, and I got into local MNC as a graphics designer on part-time basis. And that's the first time I learned how to actually work with a corporate disciplined team. And that is something which architecture probably wouldn't teach me, but is required if I want to probably start my own architecture firm, because I would need to think about HR, finance, admin, customer sales representative team, or something like that. Because ultimately, running an architecture firm is not only based on the beautiful design that we are doing, right? It is a business. I am dealing with clients. I have to tell my client that where he is right or not, where he or she is right or not. So how do I develop those? And that was just the basic of, you know, probably learning. Because once I did that, I realized what I am good or bad at. I started self-evaluating myself better, and I realized I'm quite nervous, you know, when speaking about myself or my idea, or probably I cannot communicate it as much as I, you know, I would want to. So that's when I was like, all right, since I know there are some of the soft skills that I know how to develop, there are my basic courses that I have been involved with and learning, but what about my passion? What would I want to do? So while I was going through this transition, there was a day that I saw this little guy in my university making tea. And everyone was like, okay, he is child labor. Why is he working? He shouldn't work. He should be at school, this and that, whatnot. But no one actually went up to him and spoke to him. Since I'm, you know, living in Dhaka, it's been some time. I'm always talking to the rickshaw pullers, to my maids, to whoever I get. And I love, like, just knowing their stories. Like, why are they here? It's called the Dream City in Bangladesh, right? People come to make a life over here. So I just asked the little kid, and he told me that during the daytime, he makes tea, and during evening, he goes to an evening school. And he does this only so that his mom would not have to work an extra job or overtime to get the money to pay for his school. And I was like, ah, this is a quite sustainable idea, because he is probably doing that something I would have done, right? I'm doing a part-time to cover some of my costs so that it's not a pressure with my dad. And he has that knowledge, and someone gave him the knowledge. And just imagine if you can give these people that knowledge, that, you know, how they could actually sustain themselves. And I had a business idea from that. But I didn't really know how to make it probably, say, a business, because business do have different aspect of it. then I did not know there's an aspect called social business. All I knew is like selling the normal stuff or retail business and not having an impact angle to it or social impact angle to it. So I was like, okay, how can I help more of these kids or this population or the mother segment, this informal economy, that is actually the 80% of the population in Bangladesh, right? And these guys do contribute 46% of our GDP. So I went to one of my favorite faculties and I spoke to him, and then he told me that I don't understand why architects cannot be economists or think like an economist or an historian or an artist or a sculptor. Why do we always have to think about the best building out there? Have you ever explored that? And once I started exploring it, I saw that yes, you can actually think about systems thinking. You can think about human-centric design where you can plug and play business or having a solution which can be tech-driven or tech-enabled or service-enabled. And I just prepared a deck with a business idea of, you know, how I would want to help these people, but probably couldn't develop the business modality because I didn't know how to think from that angle. My 203 credits still couldn't teach me how to probably think from a finance or business angle, right? And then I just applied to some competitions which work with business ideas. And that was the first time I realized that there are business competitions which eventually are called startups or startup competition or something like that. Initially, I just thought it's an idea pitching competition and I applied. The one that I got selected, which actually changed my life, was in Norway too. It actually happened, but with coincidentally, something that I didn't plan.
You have an affinity with Norway.
Yeah, I didn't plan it to be in Norway, but it matched with when I got the internship as well as when I got accepted, like I think within a 6 months when I came back and I got it. So it's called Young Sustainable Impact, and I made it to top 50 out of 8,000 applicants. I was super excited. I was like, okay, I'm going to do something about it. And in the next round, I'm going to make it. But the next round was to actually show your business model, your revenue, your traction, your client. And I was like, what the hell are these? And eventually, I couldn't apply. And whatever I gave them was just probably, say, a budget. Like, I will get this much money and how I will do it. But that's not what they wanted. And I did not get selected as a top 25 businesses to pitch. So I reached out to the team. I emailed them and I told them that how can I learn to do this, because this is something that's required in my country. And I did that proactiveness, and I feel like being inquisitive, and you know, this is also part of, you know, being a like thinker. You think and you are inquisitive. You are not being a traditional thinker, you're being an innovative thinker. So I emailed them and I told them, and the COO, Alex, he got back and he set up a meeting with me because he found it interesting, the idea, or how I couldn't probably shape it up, and he would want me to learn. And that's when my journey to this social entrepreneurial world started. And I became one of their team members leading the international affairs, but in a voluntary position back then for the Bangladesh domain. They were in 5 other countries, including China, Singapore, Canada, as well as Norway. And met so many social entrepreneurs or impact entrepreneurs who were working on an idea and had a business model into it. And then I got to know that there is something called startup and there's something called SME. And also the impact is very much integrated with that. And that's when I decided after volunteering with them that I would want a second internship where I can learn this in the very best way. And that's when I got my second internship job in Ashoka, which is the largest network of social entrepreneurs globally based in the US. And that is when my eyes just popped open. And that's, I think, the eureka moment that, whoa, that's where I realized what I'm trying to do has already been there in the market, established. I just had to discover it. And now that I found the like-minded people and people that can inspire me to do what I want to, this is my niche. I worked with Ashoka for exactly 3 months, where we pulled up the Ashoka Young Changemaker cohort, where under 18 kids were working on social businesses. Can you imagine the small kids working on social impact ideas, which had revenue generating model, where they were onboarding kids, where they were, I mean, kids as team members to stop child marriage, to work on trans rights, to work on feminist activation or activism movements. And it was like really inspiring, because by then I was already in my final year and I realized that, okay, this is where I would want to see how things can be done. And that's where I kind of gave it a pause, because my next semester was a thesis and I was like, okay, let me get done with my undergrad and see how I could probably integrate tech into this, because the future is ultimately, you know, tech. You would require digital innovation, you would require digital transformation, and how you can bring an entire nation where probably 25 million of this entire 125 million just uses mobile phone, right? And that's exactly when COVID hit. COVID was actually the turning point for my life, where I could give that entire time of understanding where my passion is and discovering my ikigai, like what I'm good at, what I would want to do, and what my society wants, right? And I could give that time, because my semester got postponed for 3 months, or I think one semester. And then I was also selected by BRAC to go under this Open University Society network that we had with Bard College, which was on global activism, on female leadership. And that's when I met Ms. Kaney, my other faculty who really inspired me. So there has been my two faculties who really inspired me from my professional and personal angle. Ms. Kaney, being the Dean of Bard College in the US, made me understand from global perspective that how being a woman of color, you are even deprived from the right healthcare facilities in US itself. You are pregnant, but you will be last in line. You will not get the right facilities, and you will be, you know, discriminated. And US is so far the most developed nation, right? You don't have to be from Bangladesh. And in her course, I gave birth to my social business, Porosha, which started with that little kid, right? 1 year ago. And Porosha actually came up when 56% of maids lost their job during COVID. And when I was getting calls from my maids and all the maids that I have been talking to for 5 to 6 years while being a student and living in hostel and living alone, and, you know, those endless nights of doing architecture projects when, you know, my maid would come and talk to me and we would talk together and work on projects. And she, like, not just she, when they gave the call, there was one or two specific maids to whom I placed a job other than being a maid, you know, because I evaluated their skills. I tried to find which job would want them. And this was very appreciated by Ms. Kaney. She was the one who told me that you can shape this up as a social business and we would give you a micro funding or micro grant to continue this or start this from your student life. And that's when Porosha, which means trust in English, started, which became an alternative job sourcing platform for females in the informal economy. That is the females earning less than $100. And since, as an architecture student, I was working with the largest informal settlement in Bangladesh, having 90,000 families over 100 hectare land and serving the most poshest area in Dhaka. More than 60% are females in this area, are not poor. These people might have had a urban or migration, which we were studying during the urban aspect of architecture or the urban disaster preparedness of architecture. But we always probably sympathize them about, okay, they had to migrate, but what's next? What happened? How can you improve their livelihood? How can you bring your design thinking to improve how they would have a housing, how they would get a job, how their next generation is secured, how that kid would not probably have to, you know, sell the tea and actually go to school, because you are empowering the mother or the earner of the family. The mother being the most vulnerable, or the female being the most vulnerable. So if you know how to place this service sector woman in the right job based on probably whether they can make, what would I say, jewelry, or they can cook, or they can become a peon doing basic office work, or, you know, they can also become a janitor or a chauffeur. They just don't know where to go to. So they end up being either a maid or a garments worker, which is both like very difficult and doesn't pay you the right amount. So when that idea or project shaped up, I had three of my friends with me. Actually, no, two of my friends. It was the three of us. One of my friends based in the US, she was my childhood friend. She was in Amazon working and she also had a bit of a gap time. And my other co-founder friend who is taking a break right now, right? She eventually now works for PwC, but back then she was an environmental student graduating as well. So since everything was well connected online in COVID. We had a lot of incubation program, accelerator program that we could apply as female founders working for female rights and, you know, having a social business where the revenue is conservative, but there is profitability or earning revenue. You don't have to be grant dependent. So while learning, while designing, we applied and we got into two cohorts, which changed both of like three of our lives, because in the second one, it was just the two of us. My other friend who was in Amazon could not continue. She got back into her job, corporate job. So the first one was the local accelerator program called Yunus and Youth Ventures, YY Ventures, which was in partnership with Bridge for Billions. So it was like an entire online program which helped us to understand the value proposition and other aspects of business, starting from value proposition to actually revenue, GP margin, how you can onboard client, how you can, you know, acquire customers, all these critical exercises for 3 months. And once we graduated from there, and since I was doing my thesis also side by side, I developed it further and applied for a few other programs. And finally, we got into the Global Yunus and Youth Fellowship, which is like all around the world, top 29 social businesses were selected, and we were one of them. And that had an 8 months of intensive shaping up that entire business that we have and rolling it out in the market and understanding the market opportunity. So I was very excited, along with my co-founder, to be mentored by the director of Citibank and Goldman Sachs, who would make us understand numbers, finances better. And it was quite exciting to learn what could probably enhance you or make you stronger as a female builder, I would say, by then. Because even back then, I was not prepared to call myself a female founder, but someone, as a student, who is excited to build her own thing before even finishing her education, right?
I want to stop you right there. Why was it that you were so hesitant to call yourself a female founder?
Yeah, I think that is very much related to my personal journey of how, even if you achieve a lot or if you do a lot, there is that imposter syndrome of, you know, maybe you're not doing enough. So even though I haven't finished my education, I always feel like since I haven't been a graduate, why would I call myself a founder? That is also a learning that happened to me. And that is where the sad part comes, right? That I was so excited wanting to build things. And then suddenly everything paused. My thesis had to be finished. I was getting married and then divorced. And then my thesis got extended because of that. And I could not just think about my passion, because I would generally need to think about how to probably earn and sustain now that, you know, my family would not be able to completely contribute for my livelihood because of my dad's health deteriorating. So everything together hit between 2019 to 2020, when I was actually getting done with my education. Architecture degree is 5 years, so this was like the fifth to 5.5 years when all of this was happening together. And that is where I think I flipped as a person. Everything that Tahrim grew up learning, that okay, girl has to be like that, a woman has to be like that, she cannot say this, say that, started to be unlearned. And it started with first not being able to continue Borussia. It was paused. I finished my education while going through my divorce, which was very tough because it strained away my mental well-being. I had to drop, I think, yeah. And I could see my family even suffering because of my dad's health issue. And at the same time, thinking that since, you know, whether I'm lagging behind to probably get a job or a job that would not pay me as much as it was paying me in Norway. Like, I was blessed to get a certain amount of money when I was working in Europe, but when that transitioned to the similar kind of a job in Bangladesh, it wouldn't pay me as much. So the savings would probably run out as well. Or, you know, how do I, you know, calibrate this entire situation? And that's when I realized as females, we are very helpless. Because that's when you hear a lot of people saying that make the marriage work. It will make you a complete woman, having a family, being able to keep your husband. I don't think necessarily that it's a bad thing to want a family or to make it work. You can be a family person, that can be your cup of tea, but nobody ever asked me what would I probably want, right? I probably
would you like
was
in a marriage,
doing,
right? What
yeah.
would you like in a marriage?
Yeah. Would I want that? Would I be happy? What would make me happy? Why do I have to do something to please the people, especially my parents or the society or my immediate relatives?
I also asked if it was an arranged marriage.
Yeah, it was actually somewhere in between, because like he was a guy from my school, we were similar circle, senior friend, well educated, but unfortunately he was a drug addict, and that influenced his activities with me and made me see this different side of him which I didn't see prior to getting married. And all these things happened very quickly as well, within 3 months, the marriage and also it breaking up. But I feel like the fact that I saw this marital rape, and I kind of could not be okay with normalizing this, even though probably a lot of households do have it, and our previous generation or our mother's generation was okay with this. I kind of have had to unlearn. It was a journey with myself and a battle with myself to pull myself out of it. I was struggling and I was thinking probably I should stay. Maybe this is how it is, or this is where my life is or should be settled. It took me a lot of strength to get out of that. And I started to find an organization which probably could help me to understand the situation better. And that's when I came across Kotha, the first comprehensive sex ed program in Bangladesh, because some of my friends were actually leading it, like friends of friends or, you know, similar friends. My purpose of going to Kotha was actually to learn about basic concept of consent, sexual abuse, cyberbullying, bystander intervention and whatnot. But once I went there, I met with the founding team, the group of people, and found a safe space to share and to learn and unlearn a lot of societal
norms.
I felt liberated. I was like, I can probably now say no. That's it. Probably nothing else except for the fact that no, I don't want this. And since 2019 September, when my divorce finally happened and I got back to my studies, finished it in December, and understand that who I am as a person, what I'm capable of doing as Tahreem, as this young girl dreaming big or dreaming something, that she wants to go somewhere. Kotha played a very important role, where I was a peer educator. And I was, along with the team, going to one of the schools in Dhaka, where we taught all these subjects. We developed the course content for kids between grade 6 to 8. While doing this for 6 months, finishing my thesis, and then slowly transitioning to my full-time job, as a management trainee officer for the largest service tech company in Bangladesh, I finally became someone where I could say or feel like, okay, I feel powerful, I can do a lot, and I can self-evaluate myself. I can have a conversation with myself, asking myself what I want and what I don't. And I think that is the most difficult part. That was the barrier I was having in my mind, that, okay, Tahreem, it's about you, what you want. And trust me, Krista, when I say this, that the journey is still continuing. I'm still healing from everything that I have seen, I have done, I have gone through while I'm working, while I'm building my personal relationships, and while I'm actually evaluating that, okay, what does Tahreem want and what could or could not go wrong. And fast forward 5 to 6 years, right? I worked in the largest service tech, right? And then after doing that, I realized, okay, I want to build something of my own. And I got back to my hometown, and I was taking some time to pull back Porsche again, because we were part of the cohort, right? We were building the business, and I was seeing how I could build it as a bigger business, because that's when I got into Unleash, and we had a chance to pitch to Dragon's Den in Chennai, India. And then seeing my dad's health condition and feeling a certain self of responsibility, I was like, do I want to follow my passion, or do I think I should work? and earn a certain amount and save up for difficult times ahead. And then I have a younger sister as well. So I had this weird sense of responsibility that what would happen if, you know, my father felt very sick, would my sister be able to continue her education or not? All these questions came into my mind, and there was this certain, what would I say, this tension between who I want to be and who I should be, and whether thinking about myself, am I being selfish? Because that's something I feel like as females, we always feel like whenever we want to do something for ourselves, we are like, okay, no, I think I'm being selfish. I shouldn't do this, and you should do for the people first, because that's how motherly we should be, caring we should be, or that
nurturing.
Yeah, but you're not being kind to yourself at the end of the day. So I did end up getting into another job where I was building an insurtech for the largest non-life insurance company in Bangladesh. And I worked there for 1 year, and that was also where I learned, and I was blessed with a good team. But of course, that was not going to get me somewhere, because still in my mind, I was thinking of building Porosha, right? A fintech for females, or access to finance for females, or, you know, placing them to the right job and empowering the woman entrepreneurs that was there in this economy, you know, who had their own tailoring shop and could boost their revenue to 20, 40, 60, 80%, more than $200 per month, serving beyond their area that they were staying. If you could bring them the right orders from H&M or Marks & Spencer, it was a beautiful business model that I was building while working in this corporate jobs. That's how I actually ended up like working more than 15, 14 hours per day, right? And besides this, I was getting a lot of architecture jobs as well, where, you know, there was interior design, mosque design, co-working spaces of 2,600 square feet. And I was like, okay, these are also nice business aspects, you know, how could I probably build a joint venture with one of my junior architects? She and her, me and her, we both were trying to, you know, build a team and see that how I could bring in the business, that she could probably roll out the design or the construction of it, you know, that teamwork of wanting to build things, right? And then I took another attempt to go back home and again follow my passion. And this time my father was doing a bit all right with his health, and he was like, okay, fine, sure, if you want to do this, let's do this, you come back home, you build this. And this was in 2022, and I was like, okay, finally, great, now I can build Porosha to this level and pitch to Dragon's Den and make things happen at the end of 2022. I'm excited again. And that's when I got called by Unilever, and at some point I didn't even apply. And
you were headhunted, I guess.
Yeah. And I got into Unilever after 3 sets of interview, which again, my father felt like would be a very good decision for me. And I couldn't say no, you know? See, like, the journey has been really tough. It started such a long time ago, but I'm still struggling and learning how to say no and stand for myself, right? So that is also quite related with probably, you know, accepting yourself for who you are. Like, you know, that's why probably I couldn't confidently say back then that, yeah, I'm a female founder, or I founded something, or I can do something, right? Feel a bit timid with everything that's going on. And then, yeah, I had to take the job. That has been the most depressing 10 months of my life. And 11 months, actually. I was really trying to get out.
Because you did it to please someone, right?
Yeah. I mean, and that was my dad, and I felt like it's important as an elder daughter, you have to do that. Especially because, given that in my scenario, like, that's how, what good daughters would do, right? And I think that's an elderly daughter issue, because my sister has been a great inspiration for me. She would always see me and be like, you shouldn't give up on anything because of me. And, you know, we have been each other's strength. And I think that's another very strong female bonding that we usually skip. Like, we always feel like it's with the mom, right? But then in Unilever, it has been quite depressing, because of course I am not a corporate person. I'm an architect who ended up being in the sustainable partnerships team, where I was not really fitted. I could obviously do all the work, but because of my behavior and the way I was in the team, it just created a lot of inconvenience for others, I guess. Actually, for me.
Was it because you're too creative? Or that you had, like, lots of
ideas? I feel like I am, because of the way I behave, because I'm an architect, I'm very straight, direct, and I have a certain way of speaking or certain way of thinking, which is not welcomed in, I think, our concept of corporate. I'm not sure how that would be Unilever as a whole, but definitely not in my country. And I was struggling to get out after 6 months. I just wanted out. And I was working on it. And then that's exactly when my dad went to the ICU, very first beginning of 2023. And I just couldn't leave the job. And it was a very difficult time. And that showed me the second aspect of personal development. When he was sick, probably a lot of people were saying, how would these two daughters survive, you know, alone? And then I was blessed enough to look after the expenses of my dad, and my sister played the role of what any son would probably do, you know, staying night after night with my dad at the cabin, because after being in the ICU for a week, I had to go back to my job because my job wouldn't allow me to be there. And then that's also another time when I realized that how helpless actually to not being able to stay with your family, but having to go back to again provide with your family. The situation is so paradoxical. And how can you even think about following something that you're passionate about when things are so tough overall? So that's when I realized that all of us have been sacrificing a bit by bit, and ultimately there wouldn't be enough time left to probably do what you want. And I might become someone, fast forwarding 40 years, someone who would probably regret or be bitter about not doing something she wanted. And that's what I decided to,
like, living your dream, right, when you're 18
years
old.
I'm still back of my mind, I'm still thinking that. And I think that's where a lot of women actually give up. They're like, okay, once they have the first kid, the second kid, they just forget what they would want, and they're like, it's too late already. But actually it's never too late, because that's when I, after, like, I think working for 2-3 more months, I just resigned. Because it's never going to be my cup of tea. And I accepted that, and I took this decision. Doesn't matter if my dad doesn't talk to me, which he eventually did, by the way, when I left the job and I resigned, and he actually didn't talk to me. And that happened in 2023, August. And I didn't know what to do next. It was like, okay, what to do next?
Because let's recap a little bit. So you quit your job without knowing what was the next step.
No, for the first time, what was the next thing? Because being in Unilever, you know, you had to sign a business integrity, so I couldn't do anything else other than the works. That very week when I left the job in the first week of August, I met my mentor. So I have had very good mentors. I think you could understand, Krista, when I was explaining my journey, how important conversations with my faculty members, with people who eventually became my mentors, shaped up or played a very vital role. One of my mentors is my co-founder right now, who has been in the US for 17 years and worked for Microsoft for 10 years. And he moved back to Bangladesh when his mom had a cancer and started building Amar Lab 2.5 years ago. I met him through a class that we did during my fourth year on human-centered design. It was a workshop kind of a class conducted on the second largest slum area in Bangladesh, on waste management and how females play a role in waste management. So it was a very interesting way of understanding or thinking about design. And the workshop was on human-centric designs. That was actually one of the workshops that made me think outside and beyond the regular traditional way of design thinking is actually about picking out the problems, taking it as an opportunity, and then, you know, transitioning it to a pool of ideas where you filter it as an idea and work on it as a solution. I always was in touch with the professional angle of things, right, with my mentor. But this time I told him that personal struggle that I was having, and my mentor was like, you know what? Come build Amar Lab, you join as a CXO team member and see where this takes you, because I'm sure you're going to love this and you're going to take this to greater heights and be passionate about the work that you have been doing, which is on female empowerment and, you know, working for the next generation of people and also working on the community as a whole, you know, being part of purpose-driven individuals. That's also very important for me that I probably couldn't understand, which was one of the reasons I was getting really depressed, probably not being part of an ecosystem that could empower you and you could see the real life impact in front of you. So since
how did it make you feel when you were given that opportunity?
I was so happy, and trust me, I was not even getting enough paid. But like, it didn't come with a good offer. Like, I was probably offered a salary which was half of my salary from Unilever. I was so happy. I was so ecstatic because I was finally able to build something and which would make it easier for me to completely like channel and figure out my passion. It didn't come with strings attached. It made me feel at peace. And when I channel my entire energy to it, I have felt content in developing the business over the last 6 to 8 months, actually, where after, I think, 3 months, when we re-evaluated our company, the valuation increased, the sales increased, the revenue increased, the operations are smoother. We have built up a team where there's a certain level of work ethic. I have 25 people working under me, and I have achieved so much in the last 6 to 8 months that I probably could not even achieve it in the first 4 to 5 years of working in the largest MNC. And that is the beauty of, you know, building your own thing. Probably I needed to go through those journey that all these small milestones or downsides that I've been speaking about to make me come to the right opportunity at the right time. If probably this happened 3 months ago, would not have been okay, or 3 years later would not have been okay. So I feel very blessed. And since then till now, I did become one of the co-founders because of the contribution I have made. And
congratulations.
Thank you for it. And finally, I'm being able to call myself a female founder. So a bit about the company that I'm building right now, because it's so special, so close to my heart. And the team that I'm building with inspires me every day, both Tazin Bhai and Zahid Bhai. And they're very, like, they're double my age, by the way, so much senior. Sometimes I feel like I found family in these people, and also my team that works under me too. So we are basically an Uber for diagnostics. You can do tests anywhere, everywhere. And we are helping to build up the data for a healthier life, having a data-driven decision on your day-to-day basis. We are 2.5 years into our operations. We are headquartered in Singapore, but operations are just in Dhaka itself. And after I joined, and once we did our company evaluation, we realized that we are capable of building a $10 million pre-money valuation company. And that means that we are able to serve not just Dhaka, but all the other 5 cities in Bangladesh by building the first and largest diagnostic marketplace. You as an individual in Bangladesh, like us as an individual in Bangladesh, do not have access to right healthcare or proper healthcare. Only 18% population has it. So us being there where you can do tests, which is the first barrier of any sort of healthcare, not teleconsultation or medicine, but diagnostics itself, which is expensive. An individual actually spends 30% of their lifetime income on healthcare for surgery or buying medicine. And that is only because you don't have early diagnosis. And if you are able to do that, you can live longer and you can actually save up your expenses. And the middle affluent class population are affected the most. And this population are growing at an 18% CAGR for the next 5 to 10 years. That means the population which can purchase better. So we are kind of helping them. And I'm quite sensitive about, you know, healthcare itself, given my dad's condition and what I have seen when he was in the ICU, and felt very related with it. And while working on this, I also realized as a female how I don't know about different kind of PCOS, hormonal testing, breast cancer screening, ovarian cancer, cystic cancer. So we don't know which test to be done to actually identify this and work on it, so that eventually we don't have to spend millions or thousands of Dhaka or even USD to be in a helpless situation, or suddenly one day find out, like Tazin's mother, that, you know, she has cancer because she just, you know, randomly went and did a test with her friends. And it's quite unfortunate that in 2024 we can order our favorite food at 12 a.m, but we can't order a life-saving test. And that's exactly what we are trying to change. And it's amazing that we are having the podcast right now, because we locked our lead investor this month. Verge, one of the largest health tech VCs, are coming in with a 500K. We are raising 1.2 million. We will be expanding in different cities in Bangladesh. But interestingly, the country that we are headquartered in, we will be doing 3 different R&D for the 5 million population in Singapore. But most exciting is the one that we do have an opportunity to expand in the market in Jakarta, Indonesia, where we will be probably working with some of the top clinics over there.
You know, the way that you told your story about your life, right? The life and things you have gone through, and that eventually you've come to this, and finally you're building something.
All right.
And I know that the architect in you has come to the surface.
Yeah.
But when you're talking about the thing that you're doing, is how does it work? I know you say you can order any diagnostic, but how exactly does it work?
This is something which we cracked, and that is something that probably the Jakarta market or the Philippines market would be wanting. That is the logistical angle that we have. So we work at the intersection of healthcare, logistics, and data. So we are building the sample proprietary technology with the Netherlands Embassy, where you can collect the samples, you can track it with the IoT device, and also track, maintain the temperature and drop it at the preferred lab and get the report within hours. So our trained medical technologists in Bangladesh, you need a 4 years degree for the phlebotomist to pick the blood, are trained in such a way that when they enter your most private room or space in your house, they will not have a nervous breakdown. They might have 7 or 8 people behind them, but they will be very careful and very meticulous about when they're picking the blood and collecting in the sample collection technology that we have. And it's not just the revenue or the numbers that we're chasing, but we eventually would want people to move into proactive healthcare and have a behavior change. All this testing should be done by people themselves, you know, working probably in the advancement of 4D, doctors, data, diagnostics, and trucks. Yeah.
So, correct me if I'm wrong, so it means that when you order it, I'm not too sure if it's the right terminology, but when you order that diagnostic, someone comes to your house and helps you draw blood or whatever that you need to get from you, and then it goes off, but in a couple of hours, you get to know what's wrong.
Yeah.
Or what's right with you. It could be what's right.
Yeah, what's right. Like, you basically get the report. So we are also building the largest online data repository in Bangladesh. Everything is hard copy based over here. The largest of hospitals, they very recently started their online, you know, way of ordering things. But of course, we have the data. We have had more than 65,000 tests, unique tests done. We have had more than 35,000 patients, unique patients do tests under us. And once they do, they never leave. They actually stay. So our retention is quite high as well, because you can do the test at the comfort of anywhere. In Bangladesh, the transportation is very difficult, right? For you to go give a sample, come back home, go again, collect the report, take a doctor's appointment, go to the doctor again. That's like 4 to 5 trips, taking away at least 5 hours of yours because of how the transportation is in Bangladesh. Very crowded, very disorganized, right? But because we are there, we go wherever you are, be it your home, be it your gym, office, whatever. The sample gets collected, dropped off very quickly because we have a route mapping system as well. And then online, you get it within hours at your preferred lab.
So I can see lots of possibilities for a lot of Asian countries.
Yeah.
That's why you're going to Indonesia,
yeah, also,
right?
Krista, I think this is also very, healthcare is such a, like, it's a personal agenda of mine to work on female healthcare as well, because I have been an active member in a few organizations, and one of them very close to my heart, where I am a core member as well. It's called Working Women Bangladesh, where there is female community or female professionals from different background who would be crossing certain stages of their life, right? 30s, 35, 40s, 25s, and they don't know which tests would be required to be done, even though they're like so educated, you know, they're probably thinking about making a better CV or learning how to negotiate in their office. But these are some important things that we are not reminded to think of. Because females are so always doing things for others that you forget to think what you want and what you should be doing and what might be a complication in your body, and you should be doing a self-screening test for yourself. And that's why even after 30s, if you don't take a kid, you are much more prone to cystic and ovarian cancer, and we don't even know this. So basic awareness and then doing the test and just finding out and being sensitive about your own body, own health and own well-being is so important as a female. I feel like that this is one of the way we can channel it. And that's why we have even started partnering with some of the largest female communities that have more than 30,000, 50,000 members who are not only driving, say, safe traveling for female or safe sanitary napkin for female, but also putting this as an important agenda by partnering with us. And similarly, the young population, which is growing, right, in Bangladesh, would probably hide and do some STD tests, right? Because it's taboo. But if they partner with us, we will be able to provide this test for the young population or the youth while they are probably purchasing something, some snacks over a delivery app or e-com app. So that is something we are trying to, you know, push slowly for the next 10 years in Bangladesh and beyond.
So tell me about some of the other things that you're doing besides growing the business. And we talked about this before we even hit record, right?
So there is this concept that I really follow, and that's called Jiu-Jitsu Impact, that you should know how you can like hit in one spot and that can have a ripple effect in 10 other places. And that's very important as a young female leader or as a female generally, because there are so many barriers as a natural person we got across. In Women in Tech, I taught design thinking masterclass to 29 young female engineers from CSC, Tripoli, architecture, civil engineering background, something that probably I didn't have when I was a student. And the conversation with them made me very hopeful that something like this now exists. Being a trainer while being a female founder keeps me busier nowadays, but in a good way, because I'm able to give back and share more, which will probably make someone do something 100 times better. So yeah.
And how does your dad feel about it?
Well, finally, he started talking to me in December, and he was really proud of me when I started doing my business work in Bangladesh and other places. But honestly, say so, Krista, I think there's still that underlying essence of when I would be settling down, so-called, being part of a family, thinking about what I would probably want for a family or as a family. Is a question.
You're young, right? You're just in your...
Yeah, I'm just 28.
Yeah.
I know last time when we spoke, that's also when you were like, wait, how much are you, Krista? That's how you questioned, but today you were one bit more subtle. Thanks. I think it's probably not something that my dad would probably want to question, but I think the society is something that's gonna take a longer term time to be educated. But I'm not gonna take the responsibility of all, but probably change the narrative while I go through my own journey. So yeah, my dad is proud of me, but realistically speaking, he probably is a bit iffy.
Okay, so wow, you had such an amazing journey. I mean, honestly, I mean, even when I heard your story the first time, I was thinking to myself, wow, I'm so excited for Tareem. I mean, Tareem has so many things happening in her life. I mean, you had had your setbacks, you have had your challenges. I mean, marriage and a divorce, and your dad being hospitalized. Couldn't have been easy for you. I knew that today that we'll be having a great conversation. And I knew that all I need to do was just ask Tareem one question. And Tareem would really recap and tell that journey that she has gone through. And I think it just really, you know, all the pieces fall in very nicely. I mean, now that you're looking back at it, you can actually connect the dots, like all these different things that you were doing led you to where you are today.
And I'm being able to give that time for myself too.
Yeah. Before we get to the final question, is that I have this question to ask you, like, what will you tell a younger version of Tareem?
To have been kinder on herself. Because Krista, like today, the Tareem that you're seeing, she lost a lot while this journey was happening. In the sense that I have been very hard on myself. I probably should have been a bit kinder to myself. That's what I would have told myself. That's it. Because now that fast forward all these years, I have finally been able to do what I am passionate about. I'm pursuing that, right, wholeheartedly, because I'm not just doing this. I'm actually also advisory member. Like, I'm also a director in another startup as well. That's in a stealth mode. That's why I'm not discussing much, but I get invited as being as co-founders, but once I'm not being able to, they invite me as advisory level or even director level, having certain stake at the company and guiding them. And being able to do that, I probably always found solace at work. I worked a lot. There was a lot of sleepless night. There was a lot of breakdown. Probably I didn't even have enough time to break down because I was working and had deadlines to meet. I couldn't process my emotions, and I probably thought all my conversations were pitching conversations, I probably forgot the human aspect or emotions of how things can feel. Like, it's okay to fail. It's okay to not just get up from bed and do today. It's okay to not be there for a friend who probably, you know, thought, like, you won't become a bad friend if you're not there for them. It's okay, you know, life moves on. You will be rewarded some way or the other. But because I was not kind to myself, I put a lot of pressure on myself. And that's what I just want to be nowadays. I take my days a bit slower. Of course, work keeps me occupied, but other than that, I'm not pressuring myself to do anything. If today I just feel like I can't do today, it's tough for me, I let that sink in. If it's gonna bring me one less investor meeting, I'm like, okay, no worries, let's see what happens next. Because at the expense of my mental well-being, I don't think I can do this. I started reading self-help books, something that I didn't have as a habit. My mentor and my colleagues have been inspiring me a lot to be a better version of myself. And that's where I wanna go. It's not about earning a certain amount or buying the next big car or big vacation or something like that. Those will be a byproduct of what I'm trying to achieve. But the first thing is I gotta be kinder to myself.
And what do you do on a daily basis that you could share with us? Like, what are some of the little tips, little things that Tareem does for Tareem?
I like having breakfast with my sister nowadays, you know, because I have been staying alone for like so long. It's my 10th year, right? So my sister moved in with me in Feb after I admitted her in law school. She took a year and a half gap. That's also something we both had to negotiate with each other, right? And after she moved in with me, I realized a lot of things that I missed doing when I was a kid, and that makes me reflect the good memories. I don't get upset that those memories don't exist, but rather create better memories. When I wake up and I don't have to be at office by 10 a.m. and I can just like take some time and sit down, have a good breakfast with my sister, discuss her day, ask her what she's doing, and laugh a bit. My maid comes in, I even ask her what she's doing, what she's up to, and then I get ready. If I'm being late to a meeting, I push it 30 minutes more. Every day, I'm being honest to myself and the people around me, even if it means that someone is thinking that, oh, Tareem is not as perfect as she looks like, and that's fine, you know, I don't have to prove anything to anyone. So I've been eating timely as well, so there has been a lot of health issues that has developed because of all that's going on. One of them being that I'm pre-diabetic type A. So I have started to be very calculative about my intake and selective as well. I didn't start regularly starting to pray again, but that's something I would want to do too. I feel like that's a sort of meditation that helps me. I do keep my weekends clear because I feel like that's something, even if I'm not meeting up with friends and family, but I should give it to myself. I know that this is the age I should be running, and I think I am running enough, and that's good, that's okay. Just you gotta calibrate it from time to time. During deadlines, during probably when I'm locking the investment next month, I will be having days when I can't take a weekend, but maybe now I can, so I should. So nothing extreme is good, and I'm probably learning how to find that sweet spot.
It's lovely to know that finally you're really taking action and being kind to yourself and really enjoying the relationships around you. Finally, where can people find you if they want to connect with you, want to learn more about the company?
Well, I'm always available in LinkedIn. Just my name away, Tareem Shah. If you click me, you get connected to me. If you send me a message, we can always get connected. I'm always available. And I do have like a huge group of kids, my mentees. I have been blessed with few mentors, but I'm a mentor to a lot of mentees. I'm connected to different clubs in the universities. I'm a judge in different universities, club programs. I have kids who are building social businesses. I have kids who are working in different places. And the course that I have designed, Navigate navigating career choice with Tufts. That is also something you guys can, if there is someone who's a young female professional or a young professional, be it male or female, or in the student life, they can also register to that course and, you know, go through this, like have a milestone project or capstone project that they would want to do, because a certain funding would be provided as well after 7 weeks of going through my course. That there is also, like, I think 35 kids who have signed. The reason I call them kids, they're because they're younger, but I'm sure they're not kids, but that's something I feel adored and I call kids. But I love the fact that I'm able to give back. When I see the kids, I feel very hopeful, you know, because they are the next generation, right? And I think that is a real aspect of sustainability when you're able to give back, and it runs on its own. You don't have to force anyone to do anything. So mentoring, I think, has been very powerful because of that. And I think, Krista, you yourself would know a lot about it because you are part of so many female communities. And the reason why you probably create podcasts is so that, you know, the stories of how, you know, people can resonate and relate. Yeah, live on, right? So, yeah.
Yeah. So in a way, it's a form of mentoring because I could get access to Tareem, but I'm sure not everyone could get access to Tareem. So if I could make use of that hour or so, yeah. Want to make sure that our conversation doesn't just disappear when we
finish
the conversation.
So
that's
on.
Why I do my podcast. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Absolutely.
Yeah. So, okay. So thank you so much, Tareem. Thank you for a delightful conversation. There are some people who have such amazing, inspiring stories that sometimes I go away feeling really, really inspired as well. And so I thank you. I thank you for doing what you do.
Thank you for making part of your episode this time. It's honestly, I feel very overwhelmed, but I feel very comfortable as well for creating that safe space, Krista. I'm just really glad that we held hands into this. Like, you know, you are doing the podcast and I could share it with you in a most comfortable way.
Thank you.
I hope you found today's episode with Tareem Shah insightful and inspiring as she shows us how architects can be economists and design useful platforms that benefit her community in Bangladesh. Tareem's curiosity and human-centric thinking together with business, design, and technology help her initiate not one, but two startups. Her own, Borosha, which is a platform to help women in the informal sector with economic independence. And two, Amar Lab, which is, in her own words, the Uber for medical diagnostics. More importantly, Tareem never gave up on herself despite challenges that came her way professionally and personally. She chose to redefine herself and work with the narrative of a country's situation from a place of hope instead of despair. I hope you have been just as inspired as I am with Tareem's openness and honesty in sharing her personal story. And remember, no matter the challenge, you and I can share stories that spark inspiration and change. If you're new to Womenpreneur Asia, be sure to subscribe for more conversations with visionary female leaders in entrepreneurship. For more information about Tareem, check out the show notes on womenpreneurasia.com. Thank you for spending your time with me and Tareem, and I will see you next Friday.